Good evening. You're attuned to Cafe Cabaret. Cafe Cabaret presents Blues Views with the following programming. Jim Infantino singing Video Video. Pretty Bird, a play in one act by Francis DiMenno, performed by Francis DiMenno. Rally in the Park with the Rambo Ronnie Twins. The band AC, you don't want to miss this. Francis DiMenno performing stand-up comedy. A folk guitarist, a street speaker, and Blue Optics. This is number 5 in a series of 15 performances of Blues Views.
It's got that kind of easy 101 sound to it.
Easy 101. That light sound doesn't rake you over the coals. You got enough shit in your life. Listen to this.
And then you got some voice you can't even hear. It's like... What do you say? It's matter, it's light. Who gives a fuck? Pass the volume, pass the coke, yeah. I heard happy, I must be happy, that's good. There is no here.
Spend as much time with Daddy as I'd like to, so I want you to keep him company and be nice. Do you understand?
Pretty Bird! Pretty Bird! Pretty Bird!
I'm gonna get you, you dirty bird. Oh, you dirty bird, I'm gonna get you. Why don't you say something? Dirty bird. I'm gonna get you, you dirty bird. We come this far. So what?
Yes!
To be laid low by a lousy parrot. For what?
Hello!
She had to go and buy a lousy parrot. was like looking at an Airedale with a hair lip.
No!
I'd ask her if she wanted to go somewhere, and she'd say, would I? Would I? There is nothing to fear but fear itself. What a lie.
Pretty bird!
Fear's nothing.
Hello!
Hate's what you gotta watch out for. Exactly.
No!
Nah, not exactly.
Pretty bird!
I mean, why do people ride roller coasters? Why do people rob banks?
Pretty bird!
I had to marry a party.
Would I? Would I?
That's what she said.
Pretty bird! Pretty bird! Pretty bird!
It's the anxiety that gets you.
Yes!
Rah, rah, ree, kick him in the knee. Rah, rah, ras, kick him in the other knee. Waving the pom-pom and sis-boom-ba.
Yes!
That was before you were born.
No!
Yes, it was. I remember when we got you. It was the day before Easter Sunday. You were in a hat box with the big ribbon.
No!
There's no use trying to deny it. I remember all too well.
No!
We went broke buying you birdseed. But we were happy.
Yes!
You should know. You were there.
Yes!
But not before.
No!
I gotcha!
April Fool!
No, stupid. That was yesterday. Or was it the day before?
Yes!
Of course it was. I'm not that old. Not yet.
Hooray for the Dodgers!
I remember the Dodgers.
Yes!
I even remember when they were the Brooklyn Dodgers!
Yes!
The Japs never got around to memorizing their lineup.
Hooray for the Dodgers!
Memorize it? Ah, they couldn't even say it.
Yes!
Sayonara.
Hello!
No, stupid. Sayonara means goodbye. Say sayonara.
Goodbye.
Say sayonara.
Goodbye.
Oh boy. I hate to crap out on you.
Hello.
I'm feeling really lousy.
Hello.
Hope I'm not out of line.
No.
Who took my glass of water?
Pretty bird!
I might have known. All the low-down, sneaky tricks. This one takes the cake.
Pretty bad.
I guess you're thirsty after eating all them crackers.
Yes!
Yeah, that's okay. You need your water.
Hello!
I need to get some sleep!
Goodbye!
Can't sleep on an empty stomach, but they won't let me eat nothing.
Goodbye!
I wish I could go Betty-bye. I just can't get comfortable.
Goodbye!
It's about time for me to check out.
Yes!
What are you talking about? I bet you it was one of your lousy fleas that bit me.
No!
It's no use trying to squirm out of me, you beak nosed son of a bitch!
No!
You might as well level with me. Who put you up to it, you dirty bird? Who put you up to it? I'm gonna get you, you dirty bird. I'm gonna get you. I'm gonna get you, you dirty bird. I'm gonna get you. Who put you up to it? Oh, you beat those bastards. Who did it? Who did it? Who did it?
No!
It was her, wasn't it? I'll bet it was her. Don't change the subject. She was a pom-pom girl.
Yes!
How do you know? One thing I hate is a smart aleck. I'll just pretend like I didn't hear that. Listen, that's easy for you to say.
Yes!
Isn't that special?
Yes!
That's all you hear anymore. Isn't that that? Isn't this this?
Yes!
Forget it! You don't even know the half.
No!
Damn straight.
God bless General Eisenhower!
Yeah, God bless him.
Goodbye!
And God bless General Douglas MacArthur, too.
Yes!
Who are you kidding? You never even heard of MacArthur.
No!
Boy, he was something.
Hooray for the Dodgers!
Yeah, they were good too.
Yes!
I remember them before they moved to California.
Yes!
Of course, you weren't around then.
Goodbye!
You weren't in the picture until later.
Goodbye!
And that's the first thing you said to us, too.
Goodbye!
I wonder who taught you how to say that. That's all you knew how to say for a long, long time.
Goodbye!
It was driving me crazy. I had to get out of there. That was why. Doris wasn't so bad.
Goodbye!
I wanted to wring your scrawny little neck.
Goodbye!
But Doris would have killed me.
Goodbye!
She's got a temper on her.
Goodbye!
Well, she still does. She would have never talked to me again. Hey, that wouldn't have been so bad.
Goodbye!
Shut up.
Goodbye!
Shut up!
Goodbye!
What's the use?
Goodbye!
Say sayonara.
Shut up!
Say sayonara.
Shut up!
You shut up!
You shut up!
No, you shut up!
No, you shut up!
Say sayonara.
No, you shut up!
She couldn't even pick a decent pet. She had to go and get a lousy parrot.
Hello!
Not even an educated parrot.
Hello!
Not even a parrot that can swear.
Hello!
A lousy, flea-bitten parrot.
Shut up!
The truth hurts, don't it?
Shut up!
Yeah, the truth hurts.
Shut up!
Go to hell.
Shut up!
Go to hell.
Go to hell!
That's where you're going.
Hello!
That doesn't really get you, you lousy little...
Hello.
What's the use?
Hello.
I guess I'll go to sleep now.
Shut up.
No. You.
Pretty Bird was first performed at the Alley Theater in Inman Square in Cambridge, Massachusetts on May 31st, 1988. Greg Hill portrayed the part of Herman, the invalid. George Saulnier III portrayed the part of Pretty Bird. Pretty Bird was one of three plays which had to do with, well, essentially with senescence, passing away, mortality.
How would you like to win love? Look! you a ticket. The tickets are free. Who wants a free ticket?
No, thanks.
You can win these beautiful Cabbage Patch dolls. That doesn't do sound, does it?
Yeah, it does.
Oh, I see it does, of course. please write legibly on your ticket. The governor cannot read just a bad writing. Here, miss. Put your name on the ticket. Drop the ticket in the raffle box.
What's it?
You win these beautiful Cabbage Patch dolls. It's called the Ronnie Rambo. There it is. How about that? You're going to have a lot of fun with these dolls. Put them on the big bed in the guest room. You really feel a pride, a lot of pride.
Yeah.
Oh, slowly.
All right, where are you going to wait?
It's the Ronnie Rambo. The Ronnie Rambo.
What happens now?
Okay, how do you do it?
Yeah. I'm going to go down there.
Did you write your name?
Yeah.
Clearly?
Yeah.
Okay, put it into the raffle box, please. Okay, now listen to the radio on October 5th. And if you feel your name, come into the governor's office and pick up your two dolls. The Rambo Ronnie, these are the Cabbage Patch dolls. You can win them. Here it is. What are you going to do with this Cabbage Patch? They say, oh, take them to bed. Oh, I don't know. Anyhow, it's all free. How would you like to have a real He-Man doll? A real Cabbage Patch Ronnie Rambo doll? Cool. You have a lot of fun with them.
Story of the great law of peace, which exists to this day. But when these people gather together, they only speak of the founder as the peacemaker. Out of respect, they don't use the name of that person. But there are many, many tales throughout the lands of the Haudenosaunee. Some of the tales emphasize one person or another person, different adventures. Some of them seem like conflict with each other. I'm going to take several of these tales from different places and weave them together into a whole that you can understand, and I'll use some of the names so that you won't get confused. So there are actually three peacemakers that I will tell you about today. The first peacemaker was a man by the name of Daganoweda. He was a Huron, Wyandot, Cookintock, from Lake Ontario area. And many tales about him, but I'll only tell you now that he was not honored among his people, his province, very often or not. And he left due to proxy to go live with the Kanyengahaga, the people of the Flint, whom we call the Mohawk. So he will come into the story a little bit later on. The next character I want to introduce to you is a man by the name of Onondaho, an Onondaga. Onondaho, you will find out, was a terrible and evil magician, but he was not always so. In the beginning, he was a kind, gentle, strong and brave young man. One day when he was hunting, he killed a strange bird that had a poison in it. And this poison got into Onondaho when he began to work the feathers. And it got into his system, into his blood, ate into his brain, and he became insane. He was crazy with wild, fierce, vicious craziness. Do terrible damage, terrible evil. At the same time, he developed his brain. Developed his brain to the extent that it was so powerful that he could send thought to the distance and kill people. And he could tell what was going on all around. So people cut a wide berth around him. Now the third peacemaker I want to tell you about is a man by the name of Hiawatha. Now this is not the Hiawatha you've heard about from the Longfellow poem. You see, what Longfellow did was he wrote a poem about a whole different culture, an Algonquian culture, about Manobozho, about the Anishinaabe people. But he didn't like the name of Manobozho. He went and he took this name from the Haudenosaunee people, Hiawatha. He liked the sound of that. So disassociate yourself from that character for a moment. I'm going to tell you the story of the real Hiawatha. The real Hiawatha was an Onondaga to begin with. And he was a very wise and considerate man who lived apart. And as people came to him with their problems, he always had time to sit and listen, to give them help. More and more of their problems they came was this terrible evil magician, Onondaga, was causing so much trouble. But finally he said, I think we should have a council and decide what to do. We need to put our minds together and figure out what to do about this terrible Onondaga. So the runners went out and people came together for a great council. But of course after they all came together, there standing among them was the grim figure of Onondaga himself, looking. And the people were thinking, I wonder if he can read my mind. You know, they were terrified. Also, he had paid henchmen who would report to him anything they heard. This goon squad was walking around looking at everybody, too. So nobody dared to say anything. And the council dispersed. And Hiawatha was very disheartened, I imagine. But Onondaga, I think, must have been made very angry because he sent his thoughts out. And although he probably couldn't hurt Hiawatha with his strength, Hiawatha's sister soon died, and all of his daughters. Hiawatha, in his grief, no one would come to console him. The people must have been afraid of Onondaga and ashamed of their actions. And no one came to him. So he left the Onondaga nation. He went to wander in the wilderness to the east. Many stories of his wandering. I'll just tell you, one night he slept by Bear Mountain. He had a dream. In the dream, a song was being sung. He heard the words of the song, which said, good news indeed. It is all good. It is good that we speak of peace. Farewell to war. Farewell to its cruel hatchet. Too long have we been insane. From this day we shall be brothers. Farewell to war. Farewell to arms. On this day, the great peace is made. All that we do this day is good. Then he woke, he had a dream, a vision of the great turtle doing the great feather dance. And he said, turtle, was that you that sang? The turtle said, I sang. The turtle showed him a stalk with 5 ears of corn on it and 4 roots going out in 4 directions. And he said, this is the symbol of the unity of the 5 nations that must come together under a single law for peace. And the 4 roots going out will tell the world of this unity that they too may find peace. At the end of his wanderings, he came to the little village where Deganavita lived. And these two great men, Hiawatha and Deganavita, met for the first time. And I imagine they had never been able to speak peace to someone who had the same vision of peace. They must have been so excited. They must have stayed up all night long sharing their visions of peace. And Deganavita said, I have a vision of a great hole that is dug in the ground. And all the weapons of the world are cast into this hole to be carried away by the waters under the earth. And into that hole, we will plant a great tree of peace, the tree of the long leaves, the white pine, will pierce up into the spirit world. And an eagle will sit on top and look out over the peace and call forth when there's any danger. And those 4 white roots will go out from that tree into all 4 directions, so that anywhere in the world, any nation, and any person can reach out and find a white root and trace back to the shelter of the tree of peace. Together they devised the law of peace, the great law, that all the nations could come together. And they went to speak to the nations, to the 5 nations that there were at that time. The Mohawk, the Oneida, the Cayuga, and the Seneca. And all those 4 nations agreed Hiawatha did the speaking, for it is said that Degatawita had some impediment in his speech, but Hiawatha was so eloquent, so clear, so simple, so down to earth. He spoke heart to heart, so that the people had tears come to their eyes and say, too long we have been insane. We must be brothers and sisters. We must work for this people. We will join if the other nations will join. Now, only remain Onondaga, where lived the terrible Onondaga. Hiawatha and Degatawita came forth from their council and spoke to the people and said, now it is time for us to go and confront Onondaga. Not as an enemy, not to kill him or hurt him, but to convert him over to the ways of peace. And I imagine that the people must have all looked at each other and said, that sounds like a pretty good trick. I'd like to go along and see how they pull that off. Because they all fell in behind the two great men as they went through the forest. And they walked along. And they got Degatawita taught them songs of peace. They began to sing together as they walked. It was the first peace march. The first walk for peace as they went through the forest singing all the different villages along the way. People would come out of their houses and say, what's going on? They say, they're marching to Onondaga, to confront Onondaha for peace. And they'd say, well, they got to see this. And they would start to fall in. So there were hundreds of them. And the crows that always watched for Onondaha were lulled by the songs and the music. So that Onondaga suddenly looked up and saw hundreds of people coming into his clearing, singing songs of peace. Must have blown his mind. Because nobody ever came close to him, you know, before. They feared him so much. And here they all just walked right in and gathered around and sat down, singing their song of peace. He didn't know what to do. He was amazed. And then Degatawita went up to him. He reached out his hands and touched him with his hands and his healing touch. Touched him in the places where his body was twisted, tight, hurting, began to smooth and heal his hands. And Hiawatha reached out him with his comb and began to comb his hair. Snakes were living in his hair. And he combed those snakes out. And all the poisons began to drain away from Onondaga's brain. And he began to get soothed. Being massaged and his hair combed, he began to mellow out. He laid back to listen to Hiawatha, who spoke to him and said, oh, great Onondaga, we come here today to honor you. We come with a proposal of peace for all the nations, and we wish to plant the tree of peace here in your nation, in the Onondaga nation. And here we would kindle the great fire, the central fire of the great peace. And who should be the keeper of that fire? The one to call the nations together to council, the one to suggest the topics to be discussed, to solve the problems and differences among us. Why, who but you, Onondaga, great leader of the Onondaga? From this day forward, your name should be remembered for all time, for its wisdom, for your great love of the people, for your dedication to peace. And now, as the poison drained away from Onondaga's mind, he was soothed. He began to feel again the person he had been all along underneath all this poison. His true love that was always there came out. His feelings for peace, for the people, for cooperation. His wisdom, his sense of himself, his image. He knew who he was. He was a leader of the people. He could bring people to peace and cooperation. And he accepted it. And now that peace has lasted for 1,000 years. It's a model to all the world. Every day, every year, the Haudenosaunee people meet in a great council. and the great law of peace is recited from memory in their language. And it begins, I, Deganawita, do plant the tree of peace here in your territory, O Odadaho, in the nation of the Onondaga. And to this day, the firekeeper of the central fire is always named Odadaho. And one of the chiefs from the Mohawk Nation is always named Hiawak. And Benjamin Franklin came in 1743 to make some treaties with the Indians then. And they told him, you should bring your colonies together into a unity like this. And he studied it. He said, this is good. And he told his friend Thomas Jefferson. They said, no, our people should have freedom like this and a unity like this. And they began to speak of that and build that in to the Articles of Confederation and the Constitution that all the world has copied. But they forgot very important things, unfortunately. I mean, one of the most important, immediate, obvious things they forgot or didn't bother to look into was that the real power in this League of Nations of the Iroquois was in the women. You see, it was the women who could appoint those chiefs and take their antlers away if they weren't doing the right thing. And I've been with those people. I know that when the women meet in their clans, the men stop and wait for their instructions. The clan mother comes out. She's the one who can put things straight. Now, they said, all men are created equal. But the women didn't have the vote. The women couldn't have the property. So it was through all the world. How are you going to have a peace like that? They said, in God we trust, but in the League of the Great Peace, whenever people gather together for just any kind of a gathering at all, they will spend 40 minutes thanking the Mother Earth and greeting her, thanking the waters and the winds, the grasses, the strawberries, the maple trees, all the little things that grow, put their roots into the ground, all the little animals that crawl on the ground, run, play, the insect people, the bird people, the fish people, the great star nations and the creator. Everyone will remember their part of a great web of creation and that all are our relatives. And with this reminder, then they can discuss together. Then they can become of one mind. They don't have to have factions. The left and the right, the Republicans and the Democrats. Because they're of one mind. They can find the human thing to do. But most important of all, what can be learned from this league? You remember when they had this vision of a hole that they would throw all the weapons into? They didn't say, we're going to throw all the weapons of the world into this hole except the Pershing missile. They didn't say, we're going to throw all the weapons of the world into this hole except Star Wars. They said, we're going to never use violence to solve our problems again. That was the new way. That's the new way of thinking. We're going to solve our differences by talking, by thinking, by feeling together. That's the faith. You see, so when people get together and start trading their, oh, well, we'll cut this arms out if you cut this arms out, that's not the point. The point is we bury them all in the earth. And we, from now on, settle all our differences this way. You see how powerful this story is. You can go forward now and tell this story. You can say, hey, I found out there's a peace that's lasted on this continent for 1,000 years and we don't even talk about it. But they're meeting every year together and they're at peace with each other. And you can't even bring a pocket knife into that conference if you go. You can't even have a sharp knife when you eat. You might hurt somebody. See, because it's a new way of thinking, 1,000 years old, we should catch up to it. Our people, I'm from the Wampanoag Nation. We joined in with a group, and we heard about this too. You see, those white roots of peace go out for all nations, and everybody can join. So you can all tell this story. And tell everybody that they can become part of this great peace. They can make this great peace. We can do it so that all the world will gather together one day and sing. Good news indeed. It is all good. This day we speak of peace. Farewell to war. Farewell to its cruel hatchet. Too long have we been insane. From this time forth we shall be brothers and sisters. Farewell to war. Farewell to arms. This day the great peace is made, and all that we do this day is good. There is a peace march going on right now, starting down in Portsmouth. You could catch up with it if you went down there. You could meet it in Brattleboro on the 21st and the 22nd. You could come down at the end of it and all be together in Groton, Connecticut at the submarine yard there on the 6th and 7th of September, and show that there are people who are for a real peace. And if you'd like to learn to tell this story, I just recorded it on a cassette, and I haven't had anyone.
Okay, you can start anytime.
Dear Mr. Jesus, I just had to write to you. Something really scared me when I saw it on the news. Story about a little girl being black and blue. Jesus,
thought I'd take this right to you.
Dear Mr. Jesus, I don't understand why they took her mom and dad away.
We know that they don't mean to hit without a angry hand. Jesus, thought I'd take this right to you.
Please don't let them hurt your children. They need love and shelter from the cold. Please don't let them hurt your children. Keep them safe and warm. Dear Mr. Jesus, they say that she may die. Oh, I hope the doctors stop the pain. I know that you can save her and take her up to the sky so she would never have to hurt again. Please don't let them hurt your children. They need love and shelter from the cold. Please don't let them hurt your children. Won't you keep them safe and warm? Dear Mr. Jesus, I don't understand.
Nope.
Dear Mr. Jesus, I just had to write to you. Something really scared me when I saw it on the news.
Dear Mr.
Jesus, please tell me what to do. And please don't tell my daddy that my mommy hits me too. Please don't let them hurt your children.
The white generation.
Some of the faces are showing.
Why aren't you telling jokes up here? You know, this is my favorite band to listen to, and I'm just sitting around the old campfire, drinking gasoline, and slandering my betters.
Joel!
It's AC.
Thank you.
that have lots of deep political meaning to them. Ready? One, two.
Really fast. These songs aren't just fast, they're wicked fast.
Francis DiMenno, please don't hurt me. Boom! Do you see this headline in today's Herald? School chief keeps his job. What a controversial headline. What's going to be next? Beer makes you fat. Clowns are funny. You ever hear that expression, there's many a slip twixt cup and lip? What convention of Einstein's came up with this one? I don't know. Ha ha ha. Governor Dukakis got rid of happy hour. Isn't that just like him? Now he's coming out with angry hour. The doorman stabs you with the hors d'oeuvre toothpicks as you come in the door, and the drinks cost you an arm and a leg, literally. Leon Spinks is the bartender. And here's how the bartender deals with rowdy drunks. Hey, buddy, you're an alcoholic. I'm cutting you off. And don't come back. People say I'm my own worst enemy, you know? They say I'm my own worst enemy, and I believe them, and that proves it, I guess. I want to get married just so I can have a really messy divorce. I'm my own worst enemy. Went to the doctor, and he said, Mr. DiMenno, I'm sorry to tell you that you're impotent. And I said to him, well, it's okay, my wife's frigid. 2 plus 2. I'm dying to write an anti-Muslim novel. Just like Salman Rushdie. Cat Stevens says that Salman Rushdie should be condemned to death for writing that book, The Satanic Verses. So he's going to come out with a new single. Peace train riding through the city, ride on it, kill him. Somebody told me he's working on a new novel. It's called Buddha, You Big Fat Suck. Remember Casey Kasem? He had his American Top 40. Wasn't he terrific? And he'd always read these letters from his readers. And now from Jerusalem we have, I can't do a Casey voice anymore, I used to be able to. Now from Jerusalem we have Mrs. Iscariot. Dear Casey, my son got mixed up with a bunch of religious fanatics and now they're accusing him of being a traitor. What do I do? Well, Mrs. Iscariot, I don't know. Huh, I blew that one. Okay, fine. hey, you know, when I muff a joke, it gets bigger laughs, so I'm going to muff them all from now on. I had a dream. I dreamed I was in California. And when I woke up, I had broccoli on my breath, I reeked of gasoline, and I had 20 fewer IQ points. Now, here's a real tragedy. This is actually something personal. The day you wake up and you realize that you're not as smart as you thought you were, doesn't it make you real mad? It makes me mad. I got a pet. It was a parrot. But unfortunately, I found out later it was a mafia parrot. And even worse, I found out that it squealed on the mob. So next day I get up, look in its cage. There's a seahorse's head in the bottom of the cage and a note. Lay off, blabbermouth, signed, the mob. Well, I got rid of that parrot. I put its feet in a little bucket and threw it in the bathtub. Then I got a canary, and I said, geez, you know, this canary is stuck in his cage. He doesn't ever get out, and so I figured I'd take him out. So I took him to a coal mine, and he died. Just like that joke. I don't watch much TV, and that's because I have principles. The only shows I'll watch are written by American Indians. Unfortunately, the plots tend to be kind of monotonous, like they all center around broken treaties and genocide, recipes for pemmican, and how to make yourself bulletproof. Now here's something, a nice recruiting ad for the Army. Be a hostage and see the world. Or at least a very small part of it. You ever been to Disneyland?
Yeah.
All right. You know what the magic of Disney is? The magic of Disney is getting two-year-old children to worship a giant rat. And, well, I was going to tell this joke about Disney, the food that you get at Disneyland, like Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck. But I don't know. Is that really funny?
No.
They have a...
No.
Well, okay. Then I'll try the next one. There's a museum of ad figures in San Francisco. It's like a museum of advertising. And I went there and I met the wife of the Quaker Oats man. And she was a dead ringer for Barbara Bush. Remember when Jimmy Carter said he had adultery in his heart?
Lust.
Oh, okay. Well, he had lust in his heart. Well, the heart is not the area of the body that one usually associates with lust now, is it? I don't know. Just goes to show.
He had a heart on.
Okay. Yeah, he had penthouse. And, you know, there's a special room in the White House that's devoted to the sex lives of the presidents. And Reagan's room is filled with Tristan. Remember when Kitty Dukakis had a neck brace on? You know how that happened? She bent over backwards, literally, to support the governor. I think we should all support the governor. Why did Bush pick Dan Quayle? You know, they put Dan Quayle down. They say, oh, he's not so bright, but you know, he was on the College Bowl and his team won. Unfortunately, the other team was a rack of Dunkin' Donuts. I think the reason that Bush picked Dan Quayle is because, there was always scandals with adultery, they got hushed up real quick, and then Dan Quayle was picked as vice president. 2 + 2. It's going to come out in the New York Post about a year from now. I fucked Marilyn Quayle. Yeah. I don't know. I wanted to tell you about bumper stickers in Braille. I invented a bumper sticker in Braille that says, if you can read this, you must be blind. I have an uncle. His name is Uncle Al. And, his name was Uncle Al, but everybody used to call him Uncle Alky. And I also had a cousin. His name was Cousin Toby. He was actually my uncle, but he was only a few years older than me, so I called him my cousin. And I used to go to Uncle Toby and say, those big kids are picking on me. And, you know, come on, let's go and beat them up. And Uncle Toby would say, hey man, mellow up. Like, here, have some of this spleef and you won't even mind that they're beating you up here. Well, predictably enough, when Uncle Al meets Cousin Toby, hey man, what are you looking for in that bottle? Are you gonna find what you're looking for in that bottle? I don't know, I haven't looked in all the bottles yet. When I find a bottle that says Al, I'll let you know.
One more minute, Francis.
I only have 15 more seconds, so thanks. That's it. You ever hear of disgruntled employees in the workforce? You read about this.
Lonnie Gilchrist.
Who's Lonnie Gilchrist? Who's?
Shot his boss.
Shot us?
He shot his boss.
Oh, why?
He was a disgruntled employee.
Oh.
Let him tell the jokes.
So what's the opposite of Lonnie Gilchrist? Employees who grunt with satisfaction every time you throw them a nickel. Employees who float in the air every time you pat them on the head. Thank you, boss.
Where are those employees? I want to get some of those.
Yeah, really, instead of this, like, malingering son of a bitch. I'm going to leave you with this thought. They're always talking about shiftless bums. All right, fine, shiftless bums. Just what we need, aggressive bums.
Give me a fucking raise or I'll fucking strangle you, you son of a bitch.
Thank you all. That's my theater there. I guess we're going to have to bring on Tyrone now. After that, anything will be an improvement. Mr. Tyrone, will you please come up and grace our stage? We also have a vegetarian platter coming up in a couple of weeks. And thank you.
Black as night. But you know I'm still sweet Papa Vesta. Everybody's gone. And this probably won't be heard by anybody, but I'll say it anyway.
I hear it.
My name is Carlos. I've been on the streets. I know you, Walter. I know you. I've been on the streets for 20 years. Not because I've had to, but I wanted to. Because in the streets I found a lot of the lovers of the world. I've been in insane asylums, I've been in prisons. And in these places, I found the sensitive people that we have of our society. The dispossessed are the ones that have the heart that the world needs to change itself to a human place.
Hey,
I'm 45 years old. I don't have anyways much to show for it. But there's a history that can only be known orally of the poor.
Everybody up in
the history of Resurrection City in 1967, when 150,000 of us parked and lived for 3 months at the Washington Mall, which turned out to be Mud City, USA, which turned out to be a crucifixion.
You broke the microphone.
I don't need it. I don't want it. 150,000.
We're experiencing technical difficulties. Please stand by. We are having technical difficulties here.
Has become so rigidly uniform.
so mediocre, so characterized by repetitions and half-truths, and in this regarding so all-encompassing, I am totalitarian, that never have we been so divorced from our own potential metamorphosis, from our potential through convulsive upheaval, individual, social, and cultural, toward the authentic realization of unfettered liberty. The managerial bourgeoisie, the educated public, at all times hungry for the newest sensation, has become habituated to the mise en scène of modernist despair, even to the furthest imaginable degree of human suffering, state-sponsored torture, genocide, world nuclear immolation. In a public increasingly proficient in a palliative, assimilative gluttony, the spectre of atrocity is shorn of its power to crack the thickening shell of complacency. Atrocity is assimilated, assigned a value relative to the prevailing social prejudices, artistic trends, national interests. We see that the character of the libertarian revolt, if it is to retain its adversary power, must be subversive, must remain tactically non-assimilable. Only in revolutionary tactics of surrealism, in the principle of the mental outcome, in the practice of automatism, and in the exploration of the revelatory manifestation of objective chance, do we find the means by which to reaffirm the primacy of desire and thereby clear the way for the unrestrained trajectory of the purified imagination. In asserting the primacy of desire, we deal the death card to the old myths, symbols, prejudices, and to the ancient dualistic structures of thought which serve to perpetuate them. We engage ourselves in the creation of a new language, a new climate of poetic sensibility, amorphous and spontaneous as opposed to linear and servile. And one of the chief ascertainable characteristics of this revolutionary sensibility consists in the fact that it will remain incomprehensible, non-assimilable, to those who, because of vested interests, opportunism, or bourgeois immutability, refuse to participate in the act of its discovery. Brian, what a wonderful man, what a wonderful man. This is Jerzy Hiko Dakari, who took off with the penis. He went back home. Said if he could figure out how to make money as a jazz musician, he'd probably come back. But there ain't no money in jazz. This is what they tell me. These jazz shows, jazz shows go on all the time. All these musicians, nobody comes to see them. Sad, sad, sad. They introduce themselves at some time. People. are, after all, the reason for all of their learning. How about it? That's my beard. I have to remember that for a bit. You should be sitting there cranking it up, getting it to feed back as much as possible, because that's what you see in front of you. It's a color feedback rather than a sound feedback. It's like taking your guitar and slamming it up against your amplifier and letting it go, wah! These guys with their words, they don't do much of that. So I'm going to let this play out. Let's get on it. Let's get on a stick here and clean our neighborhood up, all right? Just jump out there and pick that trash up after you throw it down. Why can't street musicians play their music in Kendall Square? This is a difficult question to answer. But with all of those middle management personnel running around Kendall Square, I would think there was a vast amount of small change be picked up by the street musicians. And such beautiful areas to play in. I mean, there's a park in there with trees and, a folk singer would do just great there. A juggler would look marvelous. I believe that we should think about this a little bit. Oh, that's too bad. And maybe get Central Square opened up to the street musicians so we can have music everywhere in the city. And it doesn't cost anything unless you want to throw a nickel in their bag. And that feeds them for a day. Hey. But I wonder about it, you know. Why won't they let... Now, street performers tend to be rather socially active people. And maybe they don't want the middle management people to start thinking about their position in life and the wonderful things that go on in other parts of the world. Oh, my. Well, listen, this band's going to take you out. If you want to talk to anybody like me, my name's Tom Blue, and I shoot this video stuff, and I'm at 864-6979, but you can only reach me at that number between 11 and 1, okay? That's the only time I'm ever there. If you believe that. I'd like to thank all these fine folks that allowed me to perform my own. And I'd like to thank the camera companies that make these wonderful machines that allow anybody to just go out and take artwork instantly. Like really incredible, really incredible. And easy, I mean, everybody could do it. You know?
It would be wonderful if we had everybody walking around the streets of Canada looking at the beauty of these. Too bad we have to be on air from all them fools that built brand new buildings with oil burners in them. And we have to breathe their smoke. Brand new buildings. Crazy, crazy. Thank the kind people at Joseph's Bakery who allowed me to run a small video display. I start at 9 o'clock in the morning and run tapes all day. It's a very interesting thing to do. That's Joseph's Corner Bakery. I'd like to thank Nadia and Joseph personally for allowing this exhibit to be brought to fruition as they say. I bet you didn't hear any of this. I bet you don't have any idea what I said the whole time. These guys are just blowing by and I'm just talking underneath them. I bet. Watch this show to this point, or maybe you just turned it on 5 seconds ago. Come back again. We're on every Thursday night from 7 to 9 o'clock. And if you got a hankering to hear something really good, listen on Monday night. On Monday night, there's a show called The Stone Street Poets. Now, I don't believe you'll ever hear on there. It's on Monday night from 7 to 9. And, wow, that's a nice one. A little bit younger. Oh, that's expensive. We're not both of them. Dial all the way up. I mean, just freak out of your set. You know, really, just take your television and slide that dial around or run that slide part and make the colors just as bright as possible. Take it off automatic tuning. Okay, whatever they call that stuff. And freak your television out. You know, and turn the brightness all the way up and turn the definition all the way up. Hit the power surge on it to make it really bright. It's the only way you're going to see anything, because when they put this over the table, it gets washed out. But how would you ever know that? It's all you've ever seen it on a cable. Interesting concept. I'll have to think about it a little bit. But anyway, I want you to do that. Incredible. Billy Ruane is a very nice fellow. He introduces me to all of his music. come down to Charlie's Tap Monday nights from 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock and read some poetry for us. We like poets. On the other hand, come down and visit me while I'm running my videotape. Watch my television program. Goodbye.